brought to you by Penguin.
Elizabeth, An Intimate Portrait. Written and read by me, Gyles Brandreth. Prologue. September 2022. It is Tuesday, the 6th of September 2022. 70 years and 7 months, 25,780 days since Elizabeth II became Queen. I'm sitting in the Royal Library at Windsor Castle, in the Elizabeth I Gallery, the third of the three remarkable rooms that make up the library and house its many treasures, from Henry VIII's Bible to the first folio of Shakespeare's plays that King Charles I read and annotated as he awaited his execution in January 1649. As I begin this book, my account of Elizabeth II, planned for publication after her death, this beautiful library seems a fitting place to contemplate the mystery of monarchy and its peculiar and undiminished hold on the public imagination. For more than 1,000 years, in Britain, our kings and queens have been central to our island's story. And curiously, now, in the 21st century, when the sovereign is no longer an executive monarch and has no real power to speak of, around the world there continues to be a fascination with the British royal family. Britain was once the centre of a global empire, no longer. Ours is only the 21st most populated country in the world, with the 6th largest economy. But every survey shows that our monarch remains the most famous head of state on earth. Elizabeth II is a global figure, the longest-serving sovereign in our history, and, at home and abroad, arguably the best-loved and most respected. Windsor Castle is the oldest and largest inhabited castle in the world, originally built by William the Conqueror in the 11th century, following the Norman invasion of England in 1066. It has been used by kings and queens since the time of Henry I, who reigned from 1100 to 1135. Elizabeth II often claimed it as her favourite home. This morning, to my right, through the window, in the late summer sunshine, beneath the castle ramparts, I can see two guardsmen marching between their sentry boxes in the courtyard below. To my left, on the table immediately in front of me, sits a small French psalter, a little book of psalms, that belonged to Elizabeth I when she was a teenage girl in the 1540s before she became queen. I've been leafing through it, with permission, and marvelling at the poem the young princess inscribed at the back of the book and signed Elizabeth in a clear and elegant hand. With her brother Edward, the future Edward VI, Elizabeth, also a child of Henry VIII, was taught to write in the fine italic script which had been developed during the early Renaissance period. In 1547, the young Princess Elizabeth sent a painted portrait of herself to her brother Edward, accompanied by a letter in which she described the portrait as the outward shadow of the body, and expressed a wish that her inward mind could be more often in her brother's presence. As I sit here, I realise that is my challenge with this book, to try to present to you the inward mind of Elizabeth I's successor, Elizabeth II. You know the outward shadow. You know what our queen looks like. Living so long, no one in the history of the world has been painted from life more often or been photographed more frequently than Elizabeth II. She has been depicted on stage and screen, in plays, in films, in television series, as a waxwork, as a puppet, even as an avatar. But what is she really like? Who is Elizabeth II? What is the nature of her inward mind? The Queen herself is not here today. She's at Balmoral, on duty as ever. As I sit here at Windsor, at the invitation of Her Royal Highness the Duchess of Cornwall, who will be the Queen Consort by the time you hear this, Her Majesty is in the drawing room at Balmoral Castle in Aberdeenshire, her other favourite home, a place with a special atmosphere all its own, she used to say. A royal residence since 1852, when Prince Albert bought the estate for Queen Victoria as a Scottish royal retreat. Today, Victoria's great-great-granddaughter, Elizabeth II, wearing a tartan skirt and a lavender blouse and matching cardigan, carrying a favourite handbag on her left arm, steadying herself on one of her late husband's walking sticks, is awaiting the arrival of Boris Johnson, MP, her 14th Prime Minister. He has come, with his wife Carrie, to tender his resignation to his sovereign. Shortly afterwards, Her Majesty is due to receive Liz Truss, MP, and her husband, Hugh O'Leary. Ms. Truss, the Queen's 15th Prime Minister, another Elizabeth, was born in 1975. Sir Winston Churchill, her first, was born in 1874. From Churchill to Truss, from Truman to Trump, from Idi Amin to Vladimir Putin, the Queen has met them all. The broadcaster James Naugherty told me that once, when she was asked to name the person she had met in her life who she considered the most remarkable, she named Nelson Mandela because, she explained, he had emerged from 27 years of imprisonment without rancour. The Queen is a committed Christian who told me she repeated the Lord's Prayer on a daily basis, as my father used to do, saying his prayers on his knees at his bedside every night, as people of that generation did. Sometimes, said the Queen, it's all you need. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Elizabeth II believes in the power of prayer and in the importance of forgiveness. She is a woman without rancour. Her husband told me that her greatest quality was tolerance. She is infinitely tolerant, the Duke of Edinburgh said, and forgiving. Famously, in 2012, in an historic encounter at Belfast's Lyric Theatre, the Queen shook hands with Martin McGuinness, then Northern Ireland's Deputy First Minister, but formerly an Irish Republican Army commander. She lost a close relative, Lord Mountbatten of Burma, her husband's uncle, to an IRA bomb in 1979. The Queen believes, too, in the reality of redemption. She looks for the good in people, not the bad. Here in the Royal Library, across from where I'm sitting, I can see a display of the ribbons of the Order of the Garter, the Order of Chivalry founded by Edward III in 1348, the most senior order of knighthood in the British honours system, outranked in precedence only by the Victoria Cross and the George Cross. The order's motto is, On y soit qui mal y pense. Shame on him who thinks evil of it. Elizabeth I's Psalter was given to the future Elizabeth II as a wedding present in 1947. She cherished it and was, she said, particularly struck by the thought expressed in the short verse the young princess inscribed at the back of the little book 400 years ago. No crooked leg, no bleared eye, no part deformed out of kind, nor yet so ugly half can be as is the inward suspicious mind. On y soit qui mal y pense. It is now the 7th of September, Elizabeth I's birthday as it happens, and I'm back in London thinking about this book, my attempt at a personal portrait of Elizabeth II. Every newspaper is carrying pictures of the Queen at Balmoral yesterday. She appears old, yes, she is 96, and frail. There is a dark bruise mark on the back of her right hand, but she looks alert and very much alive. She is smiling, looking over the tops of her spectacles at the camera. There's a definite, mischievous twinkle in her eye. That said, suddenly, here in London, rumour is rife. It is late in the afternoon, and I've just had a call from my son-in-law, a former Coldstream Guards officer, to say that he is at the Cavalry and Guards Club in Piccadilly, where groups are gathering to discuss the detail of Operation London Bridge. the codename for the action plan that comes into being the moment the sovereign dies. A newspaper editor has just called my agent to ask what we've heard. What is happening? The Queen was in good form 24 hours ago and busy, presenting her outgoing communications secretary with an honour, as well as spending time with her 14th and 15th Prime Minister.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.